of Mortal Kombat. Our first panelist. This lady made me fear kisses after seeing her fatality. Give it up for Sonya Blade herself, Elizabeth Malecki. We portrayed four characters that could compete in GQ magazine's Most Handsome Man of the Year. He played Kano, Baraka, Kabal, and Quan. It's Richard Divizio! This guy is a true rock star. His hat works great for dismemberments and for cutting pizzas. It's Kung Lao himself, Mr. Rockstar, Tony Blunkett! She portrayed Kitana and her better looking sister, Mileena, in Mortal Kombat 2. Give it up for Katalin. This gentleman has muscles in his muscles and can do a squat, which each of you on his back while singing the theme from Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Major Jack Briggs, give it up for John Parrish. He is a shape-shifting shapeshifter that shape-shifted into some shifted shape. The villain is Shang.
Unnecessary sequels with Honey, I Blow Up the Kid. In music, Dre and Alice in Chains gave us The Chronic and Dirt, respectively. And Billy Ray Cyrus gave us an achy, breaky heart. 1992 was a great year for gamers all around the globe. We got our first sequel to Sonic the Hedgehog. A famous plumber decided to trade the shrooms and get a driver's license in Super Mario Kart. And even though one game kept telling us to prepare ourselves, none of us could be ready for what was coming. When I was a kid, my mom took me to a pizza parlor in our little town of Puerto Rico. It had two arcade cabinets, the driving game Outrun and Mortal Kombat. I begged my mom for quarters to play and ran to the cabinet not knowing what to expect. I inserted my coin, picked the guy with the cool sunglasses, round one, fight. I was hooked. Moments later, my life was changed when Kano ripped my heart out with his fatality, just as my mom walked up. She gasped, covered my eyes, shouting, "Get here, so mijo!" She grabbed me by the hand and stormed out of the pizza place. I knew I had to go back, and not just for the pizza. Mortal Kombat became one of the most played arcade games in the history of gaming. It was so popular that a year later, it was released to every home console available at the time. Mortal Monday was the most highly anticipated video game event of 1993. Throughout the years, there have been countless sequels and spin-offs, as well as projects in film, music, comics, and television. And if you have questions about MK's relevance to the new generations, even now, 26 years later, not only do we get MK11, but go and listen to Lil Wayne's "Go Is What I Got," where he drops references to Scorpion, Sub-Zero, and Liu Kang. It also did something previously unthinkable. It brought video gaming out of the arcades and into the US Senate hearings where it was so controversial that it precipitated a video game rating system that we use to this day. Mortal Kombat's legacy is bigger than any one person, but the heart and soul of the game will always be the cast members. Without the cast members of the game, there wouldn't be a signature shadow kick or an annoying handstand leg grab that always cost us our last quarters. Thank you, Sonya. These panelists that are here with you today are more than individuals who just worked on a video game. John Parrish is a multiple-time national bodybuilding champion. Richard Divizio has been in several movies, including The Dark Knight, and has won plenty of Chinese wushu competitions. Elizabeth Malecki is an avid marathoner who always puts her charity first. Daniel Pesina has a black belt and black sash in pretty much every martial art. Is a gold medalist in national events and t-shirts martial arts to new generations. Philip Allen has over 30 years of martial arts experience and is a doctor. Katalin Zamiar is a successful gym owner and published her own book called Weight Training for Martial Arts. Marquez was rated in the North American Sport Karate Association top 10 multiple times, is also a successful gym owner, and get this, is the lead singer of the band called Kung Lao and the Scorpions. These professionals, champions, business owners, teachers were all at the beginning of it all. That is why today we celebrate the true legacy, the heart and soul of the game. Ladies and gentlemen, give a round of applause again for the cast of Mortal Kombat. And this time around, we learned from last year's panel. So we're gonna do this entirely for you guys. We're gonna take Q&As right off the bat. So if you guys wanna jump on the microphone, and we can get some questions going. I believe the microphone is over there on the left over here. Danny, if you wanna, move.
Yeah, this gentleman right here.
Oh, that's awesome. I mean, I don't mind the main guys, but the reason why I practice martial arts today.
Yeah.
Bruce Lee and Sugar Ray Leonard. I fell in love with martial arts when I was pretty young, but there weren't a lot of places for women to train or that it was permitted in the 1970s. So I finally got into a karate program, and then I ended up just kind of building upon that. Kept going to the boxing programs around the city, kept getting rejected, just kind of stayed on path, and eventually kind of pursued just all the martial arts that I eventually ended up studying. So for me, it's, I don't know, I started when I was 9. So it's been a lifelong. I took 1 year off, a senior in high school, because I thought maybe I could have some fun. Yeah.
Hello? Okay. I started in Korea when I was about 6, but then my dad, who was my instructor, moved ahead of the rest of our family, 2 years ahead, and so I stopped only after like 6 months of training. But then once we reunited with him in Chicago, I started training again, junior high or so. Yeah, junior high for sure. And so since then I've been training, and I guess I'm gonna have to give my age away. And Luis said 30 years of training, but it's definitely more than 40 years of training, yeah. And my dad taught, he's an 8th degree black belt, in Taekwondo, by the way. So he taught us Taekwondo, but, yes, it could be a sport, it's an Olympic sport actually, but he taught it more for the discipline and the tenets of Taekwondo. So, you know, that translates to other aspects of life, and that's why I became a physician. And one of the things I tell my patients is I prescribe them vitamin D, D for discipline. So it has translated into other areas of life for sure.
And of course, it's more than 30 years of experience. How many souls have you possessed?
John, you want to clue us in on your fitness?
Well, it's nowhere near 40 years. I'm younger than that. I'm kind of like Katalin here, or Bruce Lee was my inspiration way back in the day. Of course, I never pursued it as fervently as everyone else up here. I mean, I just dabbled for like 9 years, and it was just fun. You know, I was born and raised in California, so everything I did was physically fit outside. Nothing like today. So martial arts, football, baseball, swimming, gymnastics, you name it, I've probably done it. You know, except for out there was no ice, so I didn't do ice hockey. Plus, it's too damn cold. as far as fitness, I've been in the fitness industry since the United States military. I was in the Army for 8 years. I excelled at physical fitness and became a remedial PT instructor, which means get all of the fat sergeants and captains back in shape in a timely fashion, otherwise they get kicked out, no promotion. So that was kind of my job when I came home. I just kind of translated that into fitness for a while. And then, of course, you get married, a girlfriend, and next thing you know, everybody says, get a real job. And so I continued school in IT and graduated from DeVry and from Westwood College and get fat, funky, and full. So and one day, my daughter sat there on the bed, looked at me, and she said, Dad, you got moves. At that point, I was like, we're going back to the gym. So basically, I was off for 20 years. So when I came back, you know, it's like anybody else. I started from almost scratch, but it's just discipline. Just like the doc over here says, D for discipline. You know, it's an everyday thing. It's a lifestyle. It's just not something I do to stay good and look good and compete. It's something I do for the rest of my life. So. You know, anybody who's interested, you know, look me up on Facebook, go to beyondhumanfitness.com, ask any questions you want. I think the people want to hear from the true rock star what his experience is.
The year was 1972. I was in the Philippines visiting and I was hanging out with my uncle, and he took me to a double feature. I went to a movie and saw a double feature. The first movie was this monster movie. I don't remember what it was. And then the second movie had this guy who walked into this Japanese karate school and whooped them all. And it's Chinese Connection and it's Bruce Lee, and I'm saying, wow, that's the guy I want to be. That's what I'm going to do, and I haven't looked back since. I started martial art soon after. I met Danny and Rich, and I went to Kung Fu High School with Philip here, and it's been one road straight ahead, and that's how it is, and that's what we're doing, and that's why we're here.
Yeah. What about you, Liz? Liz, tell us a little bit about your background.
My inspiration was all these guys. It truly was my inspiration. I was a fitness instructor at Lakeshore Athletic Club when this whole Mortal Kombat thing got started, and I was taking classes from Danny. So I won't take up any more time with this question.
Danny, what about you?
Here, I got my own microphone. My childhood was pretty much baseball. I played Pee Wee, Little League, Pony League. I was a pretty good baseball player. It's probably something that I should have done and stuck with, but honestly, I got kind of bored of baseball, and one day a friend in sixth grade came to school with some nunchucks. And I will tell you, through my whole childhood, I had never seen anything like Bruce Lee or anything martial arts in the neighborhood I grew up in. No one ever did that. So I saw him spinning around these things, and I'm like, what is that? It's so full. And I kind of ditched baseball. And we went to his house, and he put in the like the VHS machine these kung fu movies of Bruce Lee, and that was it. I was like, man, you know, I want to learn how to do this stuff. And I said, where do you do this stuff? And he says, well, I have a teacher who teaches me, and his name's Dan Pesina. And I'm 13 years old, and I'm 50 now, so. I have known this man right here for a very, very long time, and he was my first coach, so, and a great friend.
Yeah, my journey started actually in the martial arts. When I was really young, my first inspiration was, there was a program, it was Charlie Chan, the detective. It was in black and white. And during one, and on Sunday, me and I have three brothers, but only Raiden was not born yet. So one day I was watching Charlie Chan, and then he did a judo throw on a guy who was like, this guy's like a pudgy detective, and there's this big thug who's in good shape, but Charlie Chan threw him, and I was like, holy cow, that is like awesome. And my dad served in the U.S. military, Korean War, but he looked at me and he's like, just like, I can teach you that. So my father actually taught me my first martial art move. And I just kind of wanted to learn more, but he really didn't remember any martial art. He was like, oh, I kind of need the bayonet and stuff like that, you're in a war. So eventually I just bugged him and he took me to a martial arts school. And I recall, you know, years later, he's like, I thought you were just gonna, it was gonna be bad, because I didn't realize that you would take this hobby and make it your life journey, your whole life. So I started with my dad, went to Bruce Lee and everything else, but yeah, I just have a passion for it. I really love doing it.
So on with the next question. I can't see who's in the microphone right now. We got somebody in the microphone?
Yeah. Yes.
All right, can we get the question over there?
Sure thing. Thank you guys for being here, first of all. I'm glad you, know,
thank you.
Make it back every year. As with every video game, there's always something that gets left on the cutter room floor. So my question is, what's one thing that got left out on the cutting room floor that you wish made it in the game, or something that was never implemented that you would have liked to have seen in the game? I know, like, Baraka had a blade spin move that was supposed to be an MK2 that was too overpowered and got cut out, so, yeah.
Actually, there was
361 there, so.
There's a lot of moves in MK1 that came out later on through the MK series, so it kind of ignited and helped the series. You know, when we, sorry, I've got a big mouth, but, example is we, each character in MK1 probably had at least three fatalities.
What's
three different ways to end things. You know, we had introductions, Carlos and Rich goofing around. When at the beginning you see a video of Rich riding on Carlos's back, and they were goofing around saying, we want a tag team. So back even in one, they wanted to have a secret way where all of a sudden, one person would be fighting two people, like in the Kung Fu movies, going over each other and kind of doing that stuff. So I hear later on that they have like tag teams or switches up, switch off. So we had like a lot of ideas and, during the first game. But I think that one of the things that I would have liked to see is the variety of fatalities.
Katalin, do you have something to add to that?
There was also some acrobats that I know Tony had the gymnastics capabilities too that we weren't able to do because they couldn't capture it. I remember Hosung's, was it Hosung or you, your flying sidekick, you had to be like staged up on a pedestal. Well, a lot of us, you know, when we jumped, because of the technology, they could only capture so many frames per second, the way I remember it, and then it wouldn't digitize. So we actually had to do almost everything kind of in slow motion, from our jumps to our falls. You know, I was originally going to do either a front walkover or a back walkover kind of handspring, and it was just too fast. I couldn't slow it down more than I did, and it was still too fast because that's acrobats right there in the air. And then the scorpion kick kind of thing came out of that, and I was like, well, what if I just did this? So there was the dissection of things that we really could do that we did in our as competitors and stuff like that, because a lot of us were forms competitors and weapons competitors, and there were things that looked amazing when you're competing, but it was just too fast to capture at the time based on the technology that they had. So it was either jerry-rigged, or we slowed it down, or we modified it, or it got stripped down and dissected. And then later on, as the characters became more of an animation and the technology changed, the characters did like crazy things that we couldn't really do in real life now, right? So that's what I remember as being left on the editing floor.
So I brought my own camcorder to the recording that day. Yeah. So some of the footage is on my Facebook fan page. I did a flip-flop back handspring. I wish they would have put that in there. I did a tornado roundhouse, but it was too fast. That I understand. But one kick that I thought they could have used, because I've seen it in Tekken and so forth, is an axe kick. Axe kick is, you know, just a high... Yeah, I don't know why they didn't use it. Maybe they ran out of time or whatever, you know, but they...
Yeah, for example, like they said, sorry for interrupting, but really briefly, like Johnny Cage was the first character, so if you look at the footage, now we have this staircase. So basically what happened was when we didn't know what we were doing. So, you know, a lot of times I would do the move 50, 60 times. And during one of the examples was I was doing a jump up and I would kick. And then John was like, you're jumping too high. When you jump up, lighting changes. So you can't really, the top of your head gets dark. He's like, so can you jump lower? And I was just like, so, and he's like, and when you jump, kind of like try to hold your feet up as long as you can for the last second. And I'm trying to do this stuff, and John's like, well, you know, stall in the air. And I kind of looked at him, and I was like, do you really want me to float? And he's like, well, and he starts laughing. And then I was like, well, can you, because there's no Photoshop back then, so I was like, is there a way where I can like jump, and I'm going to tuck my legs, and then I will sit on something and it will make me look like you can capture the frame. And he's like, oh, that's a good idea, let's do that. So he was like, oh, let's do it on a chair. And I was like, no, because if we do it on a chair, it's gonna look like I'm doing it on a chair. So I kind of looked around the room and I saw the staircase. And I was like, you know what, if we do jumping and then, you know, film the beginning of the jump and then have us balancing on the tip of the staircase, it will look like we're actually jumping. You know, because when you're off balance, you have that tightness about you. So then he was like, oh man, that's a really good idea. So if you look at some of the footage, like Kano, he was falling off a bit because it is difficult to do. You know, it seems easy to do, but it is difficult to kind of stretch your body out when you're and act like you're jumping when you're not jumping.
Right. So one quick pop quiz for everybody. Danny said the number amount of times the moves were practiced. How many times does anybody guess, shout out a number really quick, how many times he did the split punch in camera? Danny, how many times did you have to do in slow motion the split punch?
About 50 times. And different ways. So we would film it this way, we filmed one with the legs different ways and different patterns. And it's pretty funny because at the end, Tobias was just like, I think the second one we caught is the winner. And I kind of looked at him because we knew John for a long time. And he would just get started giggling that he made me do like 48 more times than we needed. So we were always goofing around on the side. It was a really good time.
I believe there's a question on this side. So somebody raising their hand up.
One over there.
Wow. Over here, we got a microphone, okay, sorry. Microphone questions?
So, when the game came out, when was the moment that you realized that it became this big phenomenon publicly? And what was that like for each of you?
Last year in C2E2. Well, I was on a date with my boyfriend in Lake Geneva, and we went past the an arcade, and I said, oh, let's go in and see if the Mortal Kombat game is here. Yeah. So we went in, and it was there. So I'm like, wow, this is so cool. And play it, and then we left, and we noticed a couple guys were following me everywhere that I was going. And I mean, they weren't like stalking me, but they were like peeking and then hiding behind things when I turned around. And I was like, oh my God. I was like, oh my God. People are following me because they get that I'm Sonya Blade in Mortal Kombat. It was really wild. I didn't really think of myself as special at all, but it was fun.
People followed me because they thought I was Luke King.
I was working for a game company and we went out to lunch. Went to Aladdin's Castle, I believe. And so we were playing the Mortal Kombat game. And I chose Kano, obviously. And this little kid says to me, he goes, did you pick Kano because you look like Kano? And I said, I picked him because I am Kano. But, you know, what he had said next, I did not expect. The kid was probably like 9 years old. He's like, you're Richard Divizio. And I just did this look like, how the hell do you know my name? Now see, John Tobias Edmund, they had never told me that at the end of the game it showed the people who played the actual characters. I didn't know that for a long time. So, and I didn't know that people were actually following this whole kind of thing, like who played who and everything. But this kid knew my name, so he just kind of ran off somewhere. Well, actually, I think I showed him my driver's license, and he was like, it really is you! But he like kind of disappeared somewhere, so I just kept playing. And he came back with the guy with the coins, you know, and a bunch of, the guy who gives the tokens out, and a bunch of little pencils, and a lot of torn pieces of paper, and everybody wanted autographs. So I was like, man, this thing is just blowing up to something huge. And that's the experience I remember.
For me, it was my youngest brother, Christopher, came home crying from school. He was in elementary school, and he said, nobody believes that you're my sister. I was like, what do you mean, nobody believes that I'm your sister? He's like, well, they don't think it's really you. And I said, well, we're going to fix this. So I signed a picture to him, to my brother, Christopher, from your real sister. And then I took him to school that day. And it gave him such, you know, props because everybody thought he was just lying. And he was like in fourth grade at the time. So that made me feel really good.
Next question, please.
Hi, how's it going? I was wondering what's everybody's like first involvement with Mortal Kombat. How did everybody hear about the project? And was it like an open casting or how was it?
All right, I'll take this one.
Danny.
Danny. That's actually, myself, Rich, and Carlos, and a group of people from area, because we were from next door, kind of next door neighborhood people, and one of those guys was John Tobias. So, you know, we used to hang out and stuff like that. So years later,
John Tobias called me.
Yeah, John Tobias called my house, and he's just like,
called my house.
He wanted to talk to me, so, you know, I was like, oh, I'll call him later, and I didn't return his call right away.
So then he called me.
And then Rich comes over to my house, and it's like, John called you, how come you haven't called him back? He wants you to help him with something, us to help him with something. And Rich stayed there until I actually called John to buy it back up in the phone.
See, the thing is before Mortal Kombat, Daniel and I were foot soldiers in the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Turtles film, the second one called The Secret of the Ooze. So, we had just gotten home from filming that, and that's when Jack had called and, you know, had wondered, you know, are you guys back from doing the game? I mean, the movie, and, you know, he had said that he was working for Midway, and they were working on some games, so, you know, I got a hold of these guys, and, you know,
yeah, so
we went in and filmed, and what was it like going in and filming?
Yeah, so John was like, I got an idea for a fighting game that I want to pitch to the company, will you help me? So we snuck into Midway at about 9 o'clock at night because he didn't want anybody to know that he was trying to create a fighting game. And then just, you know, we pitched to Midway and, you know, and in short, they said no. They thought that the fighting game was a good idea and they were going to take that idea of the fighting game and give it to Van Damme, which didn't work out, so it bounced back to the original idea. And yeah, we helped create a fighting game.
Awesome. Thank you. Let's go over with the next question. Thank you for your questions so far, guys.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you, guys. You guys are all icons. Sonya and Kitana, you were my 90s crush. So,
I think everyone will never blow you a kiss.
Anyways, you ever working out and you ever catch yourself, like, or you ever tempted to put on the Mortal Kombat song?
Oh, sure.
A song?
The techno Mortal Kombat song, yeah.
Oh, sure, absolutely. I've used it in the classes when I was teaching, and I've used it myself when I've been running, and it's great.
Yeah, Johnny Cage is not afraid to die.
That's another song.
Yes, it's right behind the camera.
Alright, let's move on to the next question, please.
Were there ever times where maybe something was wrong or someone got hurt, and it's just a story now that you can look back and laugh on?
For my story, it's Tony Marquez, Kung Lao, was going to be in the ninjas. Actually, there wasn't ninjas yet. There was only one ninja. That's a different story. So the day before we were going to shoot, he dropped a 25-pound weight on his toe and broke it. So he couldn't like throw any kicks or do anything because he couldn't hold his balance because it was his big toe. It was like huge. So.
So let's get that straight. I can still kick, I can still move, but I couldn't balance long enough to hold the pose to do this stuff. But I can still move. Don't worry about that.
Yeah, so we purchased the ninja costume for Tony. And as you see, Tony's frame is leaner than my frame. So John was like, you know, you have to do the role. Of the Lin Kuei, and you know, I was kind of happy about that because, you know, it was my strong suggestion, kind of a threat, that if the ninjas weren't Lin Kuei, I was going to do the project. John originally had them as Japanese ninjas, so I insisted that they be Lin Kuei. So I was like, oh, cool, you know, I get to be the characters that I put in the game. So, but the costume is built for him, so on the first kick I threw, I ripped the costume. And you know, we don't have any safety pins, so we put it together with straight pins. So every time we had a rip, we would be mending it with straight pins. Rich was there, and it was just, I would just be cursing and trying to move around, and I was like getting poked all the time with these pins. So I recall that
acupuncture.
Exactly, that was really, really uncomfortable. Very, very uncomfortable.
Can you tell the story about the book that you had?
How
John wanted this book.
Yeah,
this is a good story.
Yeah, well, the thing is, like, we collected comic books. So when I asked John to put the Lin Kuei into Mortal Kombat, he was like, I've never heard of them. And then goofing around, I was like, naturally you didn't hear of them. They were ninjas. Not to hear about ninjas. And he's like, well, how do I do my research on it? And I was like, oh, there's a book. And John is like, okay, lend me the book. And I looked at John and I was like, no, because I'll never get the book back. Because you know when you have a comic book, you'd never lend it to your friend because you'll never see it again or you'd get a little rumpled. So he was just like, so I kind of like, I could tell you where to go and I could go with you to buy the book in time, because we would always goof around like that. So I made John go buy his own copy of the Book of the Bag, Art of the Vagabonds, the Lin Kuei. So that's how geeky we were.
All right, let's take.
Yeah, and you know what? Okay, in all honesty, if I would have done the, you know, the ninja or the ninjas or whatever, it would have been fine. I would, you know, it would have been a fine character. But in reality, why we're all sitting here is because there's a magic about this, and I don't know what that magic is. But there, you know, what I said before, there's personality in the pixels, and that's why we're here. And let's face it, you know, you could argue that the face of Mortal Kombat is Scorpion. And if I would have done it, it would have been fine or whatever. But Danny did it, and that's why it resonated. And that's why we're sitting here. And so, thank you, Danny. Thank you for.
Let's take a couple more questions. How's it going over there?
Hi, I just have one question. How does it feel to see your characters evolve through all the games and everything?
That's a great question.
I like it. I like all the projects. I like the, even though I don't, like for the movies, I think they should have been more grittier, things like that. In the end, any actor doing it is paying tribute to us. You know, so though I'm really jealous of my brother Carlos Rayton because he has Christopher Lambert acting like him. I really am jealous of that. But otherwise, you know, when you get anybody else is doing, you know, is acting like us because we got to actually put those personalities in the into the game. It wasn't like we had a script or anything like that. Everything, most of the stuff was made while we were filming right on the spot. I would be like, okay, you're a Hollywood star. So I came out and I went like, Lou kisses. And he's like, oh, that's really awesome. You know, Lou kisses make muscles. So then I was like, we were always one-upping. So I got the sunglasses out and I walk out and I'm blowing kisses and I'm making muscles and I threw the glasses at Ed, who happened to be in the room, and I threw him at Ed, and Ed grabbed him out of the air. He's an avid basketball player. So that's all of a sudden it was just, you see that you know, it was just that type of thing. I was goofing around.
A lot of stuff that we did was collaboration or things that just happened on the fly, like the get over here. I'm not sure how many people know this, but the day that Daniel was filming, you know, I had this thing where I really wanted weapons to be in this game. So I had asked John, I'm like, are there going to be weapons in this game? Like, it would be cool to, like, do something with a weapon. And I know Ed Boon had talked about something with, like, a spear. Like, he wanted a spear to go into a guy or something.
He wanted a...
like a lasso. Oh, yeah.
He wanted me to do a lasso and throw it over a guy and kind of pull him over like that.
And you wouldn't do it because you didn't want to be like Wonder Woman?
Yeah, I was like, I don't want to do Wonder Woman, dude. I'm not doing that.
So Daniel, he had this rope dagger that was like some Chinese weapon from ancient times.
Yeah, to pull horsemen off their horses.
Yeah, and I said, you know what? It would be cool as if like the guy just like throws this and it sticks into the guy and you just reel him back. And I did this gesture. I'm like, just throw it, stick it in the guy, and pull him back and tell him, get over here. And then I did an uppercut. And, you know, something like that in the room, everyone's just like, yeah, that's pretty cool. And I think they recorded Ed Boon's voice for the, you know, the get over here. And then I think they used it in the film. But, you know, I just want to say, at the table out there where we've been signing yesterday and today, you know, I get a lot of questions about voice. People are asking this constantly. They're like, did you do the voice? And the thing is when we did MK1, I'm not sure after that, but, you know, it was pretty much just figuring things out. But we did go in like a sound studio with Dan Ford, and he's the sound engineer. He's the one who did Toasty. But he recorded us doing like, ooh, ah, you know, getting hit and grunts and stuff like that. So I'm just answering that voice question now. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff. But as far as, you know, coining the phrase, get over here, that's something that, you know, I came up with on the fly.
Yeah, he did it in the Kano voice because Rich would get into
character
like Kano. He would be like Kano. You know, Tony did it, and Katalin did it, and John did it. We would just get into a character, and there was no.
You never know what's going to happen. Yeah. Just, we're all together. We've been friends for a long time, and we just come up with stuff.
I think we have time for one more question.
I just wanted to say, I do have a question, but I also want to say you guys did an amazing job with Mortal Kombat. You guys were a major influence to me. I'm actually a professional stuntman now, so thank you for that.
Wow.
I really appreciate it. You know, you guys got an opportunity to play these iconic characters, but when you guys were first approached with this project, did you guys have any doubts at all?
I thought it was going to be an awesome game because John basically told me, you can do whatever you want.
Plus, we're like creative guys, and we, since we know each other, we were just always into, you know, a lot of the stuff that's popular now, like Stranger Things, and you see in the movie, like the Thing poster, and John Carpenter, and all this kind of stuff. We, as we grew up, we were into all this stuff, Indiana Jones, and things like that, like even like the Kano heart rip. Like, I thought about that because I liked Spielberg film where the guy rips the heart out. John's like, could you come up with a fatality? I'm like, well, why don't we just rip the heart out? And I'm like, just, you know, because in Temple of Doom, they lower this guy into the fire and he rips out a heart. And I'm like, let's just rip the heart out. I'll just hold it up like this, you know. And so things like that, we're all creative. And we just came up with stuff. It was
a good thing. From, you know, just from...
And like, to answer your question, you said, did we ever have any doubt when we were posed with the project? I knew that this was an outlet for like how creative we were. I knew like, man, this is it. Like, we're gonna be able to like finally get out, you know, the way we are, and show the world that we, you know, we're a creative force.
Yeah, and too, there, we were only gonna do 200 games. When we came on board, they promised me, because I was trying to get a game. So John and Ed were like, we're only going to do 200 games. And then I would goof around with them. No, we're going to do 201. And they were like, you know how much they cost? You know, we're not going to do that. You're not worth that money. You know, we're basically slave labor. So, but I always knew that it was going to be really cool because we were just, you know, we were geeks and we were just going to geek out on this project.
It was a great opportunity for us to just, you know, all the creative things we enjoyed and liked, that we were like, all right, we're gonna take that from there.
Yeah.
And you know what? That's what they do nowadays with films. You know, just take things from here and there, rehash them. You know, retro this, that. It was awesome.
Yeah, I appreciate the chance to express ourselves. If you guys get the chance, you should do it.
So, quick mention really quick before we end this panel, and just want to remind everybody that the cast is available for autographs or pictures at table 1180. We have pictures, we have selfies with fans, we also have a photo op with the entire team in costume tomorrow available, so make sure to check on that. Come on over at the table. If there's questions that we didn't get a chance to go over, come over to the table. They don't bite.
What table are we at? 1180?
Yep, 1180.
And thanks for you all. Thanks for
showing up. Thanks for being a fan.